It just. Well, you're happy to go, are you? Well, I'm dancing with fucking Stuart Fonda!
That's what I said. And when I did, looking up, your smile collapsed into complete shock and fear. Fear of me. But what you didn't know, that I think you sent off the restaurant that night. Well, from the first moment you told me, it began to build and toss me about inside. Well, all the new good feelings I had for you were getting harder and harder to hang on to. And very different and darker ones were rising up from God knows where in me to take their place. Things not only about you and what was happening to you, but things, well, thoughts and feelings about myself. Things I didn't know really and didn't want to be there. Things I never knew I'd give a damn about and now were tearing me to pieces. Well, I had worked so hard to grind them out of my mind. I was a grown man, for heaven's sake, sure I could keep my own thoughts and feelings under check. But instead of going away, they more and more filled my mind, started to take over every waking minute and even my dreams some nights, and all come to a head, a point where I thought their hold of me would split in two with them all erupting up inside of me. And all this at the very same time you were having this latest bout. What about me?
I said.
What about fucking me? Well, you look so confused. Well, everything I'm doing is for you, Niall. I've worked all of this out for you. You worked it all out. That one of your bloody strategy documents. You were able to give me that short little paradise, knowing at the very same time you'd soon be shutting the gates of it again in the worst possible way by dying in this ugly, disgusting manner, and maybe taking the baby with you too. Were you only able to make love to me? Like only able to be there for me in any real way at all? Only when you knew you were dying?
Like, is that it?
Well, you're sick in other ways than one. If it wasn't for the baby, he'd be lying on that floor to die on. Good enough for you to be a cold cock, you little bitch! I had just about managed to keep a handle on myself up until then. Oh, don't be selfish, you kept in. Just hang on, say nothing. But it was building up and up and up. And if I ever did feel like talking to you about what was happening in me, well, I would feel guilt, like a knife sticking into my side. Well, how could I burden you with anything? You're the one that was dying, but before long you started to feel even more pain than you were in another. And the doctors have said if there was to be any chance of you surviving long enough to save the child, well, then you needed as much care and lack of stress or aggravation that any upset could trigger a reaction and run the risk of losing the child. And look how unselfish you were being, giving me the child in the first place. I was angry. Oh, I was angry that you were leaving me so soon after finally opening up to me. I was angry for having fooled myself for so long. I was fine with you, fine with our marriage, fine with not trying to have a child for so long, fine with my life in general. And while I'm pathetic, it may seem, but I was really angry that even if we did have the baby or not, I'd never be able to show it to my mother and father. I'm choking! That my big brother Daddy had frigged off of me when I was so little, leaving me completely on my own. And now when I really needed someone for my own family, he was still nowhere to be found! And I was angry at the way for so much of my life I had watched people back away from me because I didn't feel I was looking down on them all the time. Well, if anyone was good at making people feel unnecessary, well, it was me. And I had begun to wonder if it was just that I had always felt unnecessary anyway, without you or anyone else making me feel that way. Well, maybe I was unnecessary. Maybe my father had been right, maybe there was something wrong with me. And the future I could see, left for the rest of my life, not knowing how I was going to go on. Knowing now that from as far back as my memory could reach, well, I'd not really lived most of the days I'd been given. And not being able to face the next or any of the other days stretching out in front of them. And all completely on my own. Well, maybe there was something wrong with me. Or maybe that was all this darkness. Well, maybe that was all. And when this thought would come into me, well, the whole of me would fill with fear and panic, to the point where sometimes I felt I would lose my bearings completely. The thought that maybe that was all I deserved. I know. Oh, I know, I could make that big place somewhere, me and him. Well, some of the two of us could maybe start out again from it some kind of a way. It's never too late, isn't that what they say? And there's more than room enough for we extension out the back, so we wouldn't be tripping over each other. Oh, still fit enough to do that, I am no bother. Put the best finish in everything. All them years in the sense might be going to waste after all. Make it summer, that wee girl would be happy to grow up and she might not have a mother, but sure she could have as good as two dads looking after her and I, her uncle. Oh, I see absolutely no reason why the three of us can't. Oh, you're jumping the gun a wee bit here, Daddy. Niall laugh in your face with the very idea. Probably be right to look at this stage. Oh, I can just see it. Standing there, the two of us talking away to the wedding of plan because we've run out of things to say to one another after the first cup of tea. And Niall thinks to himself, how did I ever think asking him back here and me was a good idea? How long before I can ask the client when he's intending to return to his wanderings? Mind you, the way he was to me in that phone. Well, he was in a bad way, of course. Well, still is, obviously. But I'll pray God is in him to want to be like that. Even a wee bit like that with me still. From the minute I left Tommy in that bar, oh, I was telling myself, oh, it has to be something bad. Like Niall can't just be wanting to get in touch with me. Oh, he needed some information or something. 3 days. 3 whole days after Tommy Manatee tracked down the number. Late one night. Well, I had to have a skinful first before I could make myself reach out and pick up that phone. I've missed you too, Niall. Oh, I've missed you too. Right now, I am here for you. My wee brother. I am fucking here for you now! Not a word was spoken again for a very long time after it finished telling all that to the boys. Each of us was feeling something. I knew the other two were feeling it as well. And none of us wanted to break it by saying anything. And then, we heard. We heard this little gurgle. The child was awake. And at the exact same time, all three of us rose out of our chairs to go and pick her up. And at the same time again, all three of us went, "Sorry, you, no, go on." But the boys didn't move. "Thank you," I said. And I leaned down and I picked wee Inga up. And I stood there, swaying. The two boys either side of me. The wee warm body held against me. I'm not giving up the flat in Germany. I'll rent about 6 months at a time for a while, and we'll see. When Niall was overcome. "Oh, Gabrielle, that's so, thank you, thank you. A little Inga will be so, and we'll share everything out between us." "Oh, of course, oh, absolutely. Danny?" "Sure's not what I've been saying. Oh, Jesus fucking the hell. Gabby's staying." Oh, the smile beaming on his face at that moment. "And you can take that goofy grin off your face, McGinley. I said, we'll see, only." "Oh, no, no, Jesus, I wasn't. But I was beaming myself, Mammy. Oh, I was being myself inside.